Well, praise the Lord, everybody. Well, praise the Lord, everybody. Let's clap our hands real good, because praise is what we do. Praise is who we are. Amen. And we praise Him while we can. Amen. I like that you would find at least two people and embrace them real good and hug them real good and say, I love you, and there's nothing you can do about it. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Y'all can be seated. God bless you. Thank you so much. Hallelujah. Can you hear out these speakers here well? Hallelujah. Can you hear out those speakers? Are they on? Hallelujah. There's nothing coming out of there. Okay. God bless you. Hallelujah. Amen. This is like, as the summer is coming to a close, you know, there's a lot of people out of town and here, there, and everywhere. I was in the airport this week, and the airports were jammed. I said, where are all these kids going? Everybody going with their families. Didn't school start again? And it was just jam-packed. So I guess as the few more weeks of summer's here, that there's still a lot of in and out of town. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Amen. If God get the house turned up, it seems like I don't hear it as well. Amen. We thank God for Jesus. Amen. Thank God. Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Praise the Lord. It's because He lives we can face tomorrow. I want to try to move expeditiously because we have communion, and this is something that we must start taking every first Sunday. Amen? Every first Sunday is something that we must do. Thank you, Mother. Amen. No, I'm good. Thank you. Amen. Something that we must start doing every Sunday. But while these seats are, some of them are so very empty in the front, it would be nice if some of you could move on up a little bit, change your seat, and kind of fill in the gaps. Amen. I know y'all way back there, but if y'all can get a little closer to this anointing, to the power of God. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah, that's good. That's good. Hallelujah. It's good to see everybody. Amen. Bless your heart. I want to say that ahead of schedule, that I already thank you for what the church is planning to do in October. But it's a combination of a pastoral celebration as well as a birthday celebration. I choose to do my pastor's anniversary and the birthday in the same time, even though I'm being asked to do it now different. I have a request that I have to come to administration, but that'd be different dates. But I've always chose to do it at the same time. But I want to thank you ahead of schedule for what you're going to do, because love is giving. Amen? And for God so loved the world, He gave. So giving is a part of love, a big part of love. Amen? If someone loves you, they'll sacrifice. They'll give. If they don't really love you, they ain't going to give you nothing. Amen? For God so loved the world, He gave. Amen? So, I want to pull a surprise on you, a fast one. I called Brother Dave to the pulpit, because I'm a last minute person, and that's why I try not to run everything in this church. I try to just be the pastor, because if I try to be pastor, administration, and secretary, and all that other stuff that goes on behind the scenes, this church would do everything last minute because I'm best under pressure. I love pressure. My mind opens up, my brain ticks when the pressure, I'm talking about 24-hour deadlines. That's when my mind goes. And I work best, and I've been great at pulling a kangaroo out of a hat at the last moment. I can do it. But everybody don't operate under that same pressure. And that's what I've learned. Everybody don't operate up under that same pressure. And so I had to learn when I came to Charlotte to kind of ease back and let those who I have put in position to kind of help me fix that about me. But we gonna pull one out the hat this week. Because next Sunday is back to church Sunday. And praise God. And I would like us to not just have back to church Sunday, but back to church barbecue on Saturday. So I'm gonna ask last minute that we put this together and that we have a church barbecue on next Saturday and that all the ballers come with your sneaks and your kicks and we get on the court and we play a game of softball and we have like a watermelon eating contest. Oh yes, have a little hot dog eating contest. Whoever wins the watermelon eating contest will win $50. Whoever wins the hot dog eating contest will win $50. Amen. Nathan's is coming to Charlotte. Amen. We'll have Crown Our Own Harvest Hot Dog King. Amen. Amen. Now, I won't be a part of that. I won't do that. But I may join in the watermelon eating contest this year. Amen. I may do that. And I may get on the court this year. I may. I'm kind of retired because at 41 going on 42, I don't want to hurt myself. Y'all know how you get when you get older. Your mind telling you to do one thing. That you better be mindful of your body. Because they'll tell you do a whole lot of stuff that your body can't do. And you end up in the emergency room. Amen. So I don't want to end up in the emergency room. So I'm thinking about it. Amen. But the last time we was in the park, we had a wonderful time. We had a wonderful, wonderful time. Now I'm asking that this is not exclusive to Harvest Kingdom, that if you are a member of this church and you have family or friends, anyone you would like to bring, you bring them and let us fellowship together and have a nice time together. Amen. Bring all the children, bring all the family, amen? And let's fellowship together next Saturday. Now, what you ought to do is to tune into the church's Facebook page. We still have one of those, Facebook page. And we will announce the park on tomorrow or Tuesday, the latest. We announce the park and the time, amen? And so let's make sure now, if you don't know the time and you don't have Facebook, you can't go on Facebook, I'm going to ask that you would put it on the church answer machine as well as do the hotline call. Everybody gets it. If the church doesn't have your phone number, we should have it so that we can call you. Amen? Because we do have a system that we can make an announcement and thank you. Amen. We can make an announcement and we can just make that announcement and hang up the phone and it hits everybody at one time. Amen. So we ask that you make sure the church have your number. If not, I want it where they can call the church, and when they call the church, you know, you'll just reach Harvest Kingdom for all church members. There's a barbecue, you know, boom, boom. If not, leave a message, you know, like that. So we do that. That's called last minute thinking and doing it good. Praise God. But next Sunday, I'm asking that you invite all your family and friends out next Sunday morning. Amen. As we have back to church Sunday. Amen. I want this place jam-packed. I expect a high time in the Lord. We have many guests coming, and then we're going to have service again at 5 p.m. 5 p.m. afternoon service, amen? We're going to have a whole lot of singing and shouting and praising God and celebrating in the afternoon. Morning service, our praise dancers will reestablish themselves in this church, and the children's praise ministry will be dancing. Amen? Amen. Amen. We're planning, amen, to start a children's choir in the church. Get these kids singing, these little babies. Get them singing. Amen. Had a little children's choir. Amen. And then the choir also will be singing. I'm asking that we do meet with the choir directly after church today, that those choir members that are here, that we can meet right after church this afternoon. Amen. I have a word from the Lord. I want to go right to it. It is in the book of Deuteronomy. I'm going to still stay on the pain, turning your pain into power, until that DVD comes out, but I'm mixing it in with a book that I'm finishing called Life After the Loss. Amen? Amen. And since I've been coming to the end of the book now, for me emotionally, it has been overwhelming because I have to recant many things that have happened that devastated my life from 10 years ago and relive it now. So emotionally, I sometimes sit in my house and I'm shaken up, and I have to get myself together. But it seems like as I'm coming to the close, there's a lot of people that are experiencing people leaving, losses, great losses. And so this book is here to help, or coming to help, but I want to preach from it also. My book is not entitled a religious book. It's not under religious column. You'll find it in the bookstore. It doesn't say Bishop Jesse Davenport. It just says Jesse Davenport because it's a book to the entire world. There's more people than just church folk dealing with losses. Okay? So in order for me to reach, I have to go farther than just the church, because if I put Bishop Jesse Davenport, it will just lock my church, my book, into a small group of people and turn off to a lot of others just because they see Bishop and they don't want to hear about your religion more than they want to hear about the experience. Once I reach them, then I can go on television and say, it was because of the Lord who was on my side. Amen. And discuss who I am. So don't be offended, because certainly I won't when the book is selling off the shelves. Praise God. I won't be. I want everybody to know here that everything that you do don't have to be church. I said everything you do don't have to be church. Everything that you invent doesn't have to be church. Okay? It really doesn't. Is anybody here happy about having an iPhone? Anybody have an iPhone?
Yes, sir.
You have one?
I have one.
How about an iPad? Anybody have an iPad in here? Got one of those too? Anybody have an Apple computer? Yeah, okay. And I bet some of y'all, when you got your iPad and your iPhone, because it's a great phone, it was like, the Lord bless me with this iPhone and this iPad. But what's the owner's name again that passed away? Steve Jobs. Thank God for Steve Jobs. That's what you need to do. Because Steve Jobs, amen, thought about it and made it. And probably had nothing to do with his conscience about God. Just, I had a thought and a plan. And he didn't put nothing about Jesus on the phone. Amen. Everything that you invent doesn't have to be Jesus. But we know we give him the glory. We give him the credit. Amen. Because we know if it hadn't been for the Lord inspiring me, then we'd not been able to do it. But some of you just need to start using your gift to do things that will prosper you, amen, that you don't have to put Jesus on it. Just make sure when people buy it and you get interviewed, you say, hey, if it had not been for the Lord, amen. I'll make some socks. I'm not going to put Jesus on my socks. Even though some of y'all probably would be crazy enough to walk around with Jesus socks on. I can't do it. Amen. Deuteronomy 34 is where we have a great lesson coming from today. If I don't hoop and holler, come back next week. I promise it'll be on me then. I'll be prepared better next week to hoop and holler. I've been very sick and under the weather. Even after preaching the homegoing service on yesterday, I went in the office and had a very high fever. I was burning up, not feeling well at all. Thank God for the ministry hands of some of the saints that was able to help me. Amen. And got me better until I was able to get home and medicate myself up and go to bed. But I don't have much of a throat today. I hope y'all have one. Maybe y'all can holler louder than I preach. Deuteronomy 34, that is the last chapter in the book of Deuteronomy. And I'm going to start right around verse number 5. When you're there, could you let me know by saying, I'm in the Word.
I'm in the Word.
Deuteronomy chapter number 34. We'll begin our reading at verse number 5. And if you hear this, it will really bless you. So Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab, according to the word of the Lord. And he buried him in a valley in the land of Moab over against Bethephor. But no man knoweth of his sepulcher unto this day. And Moses was 120 years old when he died. His eyes was not dim, nor his natural force abated. Verse number 8, and the children of Israel wept for Moses in the plains of Moab 30 days. So the days of weeping and mourning for Moses were ended. For 30 days, wept there mourning. Father, in Jesus' name, you are the potter and we are the clay. Make us and mold us. Have thine own way, Lord. Lord, we celebrate you at all times. We give you thanks at all times. Great God, feed us until we want no more. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. You may be seated. Just for a moment, look at somebody and tell them there's life after the loss. Find one more person and tell them there's life after the loss. We'll try to make this short because we have communion and I want to try to move quickly. Not too long ago, I was on the phone with a company so I can handle some business. The company I was on the phone with, because we are on video, I don't want to say the company because I don't know where this video would go and I don't want no problems. The company had transferred me to a supervisor. But in the midst of the transfer, from me talking to the original person to the transfer to the supervisor, they asked me to hold. I said, okay. They placed me on hold. 5 minutes went by. I was still on hold. It was a very important call, so I needed to get to this supervisor to handle this situation. Before I know it, 10 minutes have gone by. I still was on hold. So I did like what most of you do. I took the phone from my ear because my arm's getting a little weary. I put it on speakerphone and put it on the table. I'm becoming a little annoyed because it's 10 minutes and if I hang up the phone, I have to start all over again. 10 more minutes went by and I still was on hold. Well, before I could hit 30 minutes, I came to the conclusion that possibly the person on the other end is never coming back. So I decided to hang up because I can't spend my life on hold. God help me here. I can't spend the entire day waiting on something to happen that's not going to happen. God help me here. You see where I'm going, man? I have to come to the realization that it's possible that I'm waiting for something to happen or waiting for someone to come on this phone who's not coming. And I gotta come to the place that because I realize that truth, this is not something that's just, let's play around with this. This is a reality now. That if I've been holding this long, now usually they come back to the phone and say, can you continue to hold? To give me some type of encouragement or expectation that my call will be received. But this time, there was no expectation given to me. It was just silence that made me come to the truth that I'm holding for nothing. God, help me here. The truth or the reality has set in that they're not coming back. And so for the next 5 minutes, if I can hit y'all with this, is while I was holding, the signs of them not coming back was all already there. By 20 minutes, reality had to kick in. I'm trying to ask the church, why you dancing and shouting, leaping and running, high-fiving and speaking in tongues? When are you ever gonna come to the place that you see signs and understand the reality of your situation and learn to hang up the phone? God help me here. Okay. This is my first high five. This is my first of seven. High five somebody and say, hang up the phone. Phone. Hang up the phone. Because you can't stay on hold like this when the reality or the truth is slapping you right in your face that what you're waiting on ain't coming. Okay. And see, when you wait too long, you never get to the conclusion of your situation
God help me here. You just stay in limbo. And some of your lives has been in limbo because you refuse to hang up the phone and come to the conclusion that this caller is now done. Okay, all right, this is my second high five. Look at somebody say, I'm done now. Now I'm done. Hallelujah. I done hung up the phone, and the reality is I have to move on. The reality or the truth is you have got to move on. Okay, I'm going to say it again. I ain't going to preach long to y'all, so y'all better get on this train because we're going somewhere. The reality is, the truth is, you must move on. Okay, all right. The reason then why most of you stay stuck and in limbo, and instead of walking, you're wandering, is because you then won't move on. Now, why won't you move on? You don't move on because you don't face truth. I'm going to preach to y'all whether you like it or not. I'm coming down here to challenge you. I ain't coming to tickle your fancy. I come to challenge you. You won't face truth. Now, the problem with the church and many of us is that we know the devil is a liar. And you can't stand a lie. But you don't know how to handle truth. All right. I wasn't feeling well last night, but I did wake up to a morning glory. God started dealing with me somewhere around 7 this morning. I'm going to rewind that and press play for you, for those that didn't catch it. You don't like lying. You don't like a liar. But the problem is y'all can't take the truth. What is the reality of the situation? The old school churches are saying, well, I won't claim it. I won't speak it. My leg ain't broke. No, your leg is broke. It's on the x-ray. There is a fracture. I see it. It's broke. Well, I ain't going to claim it's broke. I'm going to try to get up and walk. No, you're going to sit there and let a doctor put a cast on that leg so it can heal and you can come to a closure and then be able to move on because you're broke. Okay. And when you cannot handle truth, you will never look at yourself and be able to come to closure because you must be able to say to yourself, hallelujah, I am broken. I am messed up. God help me here. God help us in this church. You got to be able to come to a place that a prophet don't have to tell you. The missionary boy don't have to tell you. The pastor don't have to tell you. You look at yourself and sometimes say, I'm bugging out. And that's truth. You got to be able to handle truth. And stop being so upset about lies. Hallelujah. And get to the place that you're able to see truth and handle truth. We are having a problem. I'm talking about a real problem. Because we're not handling truth. God help me here. Come on, you. The signs are on the wall. How many times do God have to show you? How many times do you got to go through this valley? How many times do you have to go through this transition? How many times, God help us, you just won't embrace the truth, baby. You trying to make stuff happen that just ain't made to happen. You trying to make things stick that ain't made to stick. God help us. You try to make something out of him that he'll never become. You're trying to make something out of her that she ain't. Truth is, she ain't it. That's truth. But see, we don't want to embrace truth. We don't want to embrace truth. What we want to do is recreate. God help us here. We want to recreate or ignore. What's recreate? Truth is, it ain't in him. God help me here. So you want to take your clothes off, and you want to take them out to eat, and you want to sit down and try to recreate. God help me here. It ain't in her, but you go buy her stuff and take her here and take her there and try to recreate. This is a problem because we do the same thing when it comes to God. Hallelujah. The church is messed up because you're trying to recreate the creator to fit him according to the type of God you want. Y'all ain't here. I got news for you. God changes not. You can't recreate God to fit you and your lifestyle and your proclivities. And you cannot recreate God and create him as a God that's a God for you and how you feel. It's not about how you feel. It's about what he said. God help me here. And if you have a problem with what he said, then you just gonna have a problem. Hallelujah. Because God changes not. He's God. Same God today, yesterday, and forever. Oh yeah. I think I'm on my third high five. Hallelujah. High five. Somebody say he don't change. He don't change. Hallelujah. You can't recreate or redesign God. Hallelujah. God is bigger than Harvest Kingdom Church. He's bigger than your local church. He's bigger. He's larger than just Charlotte. He's the God of the world, the God of the universe. He's a large God that has come to forgive sins. God, help me here. How to open up a door to salvation. He died for the church, but he also died for the unchurched. He's God, loves everybody. Look at somebody, say neighbor. Don't give them a high five, just say neighbor. Can you handle truth? That's just the problem. Some of y'all talk about, y'all sit down with folks about, don't lie to me. Don't lie to me. I need to know the truth. Don't lie to me. Hallelujah. You can't handle. That's why they lying, because they know you can't handle what you got. This is why people lie, because they know that if they ever be honest and tell you the truth, you can't handle what you are asking for. And y'all are so anointed, but won't you get anointed enough to be able to stand up and handle the truth? Because truth gets ugly, and truth sometimes gets embarrassing, and truth sometimes shows people stuff about you that you try to keep hidden. Truth, baby. Oh God. Hallelujah. Some of you need to ask God for another anointing that's able to handle the truth, baby. I'm talking about the truth. Stop sitting down telling folk, tell me the truth. When you know when they finish telling you the truth, you're going to be mad at them forever. You're going to hate them forever. You're going to put them in a prison and never forgive them and never let them Well, you couldn't handle it. God help me here. I said, you couldn't handle it. But there's one thing about the truth. We shall know the truth. And the truth shall make us free. Look at somebody and say, neighbor, I don't know if you can handle this. Hallelujah. Oh my, oh my. I said, oh my. Hallelujah. Look at somebody else and say, I don't know if you can handle this. I don't know if you can handle this. This is why I come to church and try to dress over stuff. Can I don't want to expose too much to you. Because I don't know if you can handle it. I don't know if you can handle it. And how we know a person can't handle the truth that you have is you can see that they can't handle the truth about themselves. Oh, God, help me here. And how can we ever really get delivered? Deliverance don't just come from dancing. Deliverance just don't come from dancing. Deliverance just don't come from leaping. Deliverance just don't come from shouting. But real deliverance is, I wish I had somebody here, when you could say, God, yes, I'm a wretch. Yes, God, I'm wrong. Yes, God, I got this broken. Yes, God, yes, God. Is there anybody in here that can be honest with God and look at yourself and see your own issues and be truthful? And be truthful. And be truthful. Be truthful. No, we all got eyes that we can look at ourselves. But I'm saying, look and be truthful. Well, I know we all could take a look, but take a look and then be truthful. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm about to go to my seat because I'm finished. I really am finished. But the next thing is, not only will deliverance come, but God can bless somebody that can handle truth. Oh God, I feel something stirring down in my belly right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There was a woman that needed God to do something. The problem was that she wanted some crumbs that fell from the children's table. The conflict is that she's not covenant. Feel like preaching. Hallelujah. The conflict, I thought I had an organist. Did we hire one? The conflict is that she's not covenant, that she's not in the family. But the Bible says that Jesus shows up and she says, listen, I need the crumbs that fall from the children's table. His response is that we don't give the crumbs to a dog like you. She could have got offended. I said she could have got offended. But look at somebody and say, neighbor, it's hard for me to get offended when that's the truth. Glory to God. I'm sick and tired of covering that the fact that is I'm a dog. I'm tired of covering that I got major issues. Grab somebody and say, pull the cover off. And don't get offended at what the truth is. Fellas, there's been seasons of your life that you've been a dirty dog. You might as well come to the truth and get delivered. Yes, I smoked and I drank, but that was me. Look at your neighbor, give him a high five and say, neighbor, can you handle the truth? Jesus said, a dog. She said, well, listen here. I'm may be a dog, but even the dogs, even the dogs, she said, this is true. Hallelujah. Can't hide from it. Can't run from it. But I need a blessing so bad that I'm willing to come into a place of truth with you. I'm a dog. Look at somebody and say, neighbor, I know you anointed, but what else are you? Good God Almighty. I know you got a collar on, but what else are you? I know you have a robe on, but what else are you? I know you sing real good, but what else are you? The Bible said, feel like it. The Bible said that even the dogs, hallelujah, can eat from the table. I want the bread. I want the bread. I want the bread. Y'all need to get this prophetically. I want the bread. I'm going to say it one more time. And some of y'all might get it. I want the bread. Good God Almighty. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I don't know about you, but I want the bread. This Sunday is communion. The wine represents his blood, and the bread represents his body that's been broken for you. Grab somebody and say, neighbor, I want the bread. I want Jesus. I want him so bad that I come to truth and I come to Jesus just as I am. Hallelujah. I come to Jesus as a whore. I come to Jesus as a crackhead. I come to Jesus a mess. I'll come to Jesus because I want the bread. Get out your seat. Go across the aisle and say, I want the bread. Somebody, come on, let's have church. Grab somebody and say, neighbor, call me whatever you want to call me, just as long as I get this bread. I gotta have the bread. Gotta have Jesus. I need him. I want him. Got to have him. We'll have him. And I'll praise him. I said, I'll praise him. I said, I'll praise him. God, I feel it here. I'll praise him. Is there anybody in the room that don't mind praising Jesus? If you want him, praise him. If you need him, praise him. If you gotta have him, praise, praise, praise. Oh Lord, oh Lord, oh Lord. I wish I had a church. It's Harvest Kingdom here. God help me in here. Wish I had a church. Where's the people? Where's the praises? Somebody lift your hands. Open your mouth and shout. All right. Listen. This morning, this morning, I don't want you to get with anybody. Find a name caller. Find somebody that will call you what you are and you don't get offended. Find somebody that knows you. Find somebody that will be truthful with you. Because those folk are the folk that make sure blessings and deliverance comes your way. You never want to be around just folk that compliment you. That will not work. You need to be around people that sometimes will be truthful. Not to the point that it becomes offensive, because it won't be offensive if you stop hiding and just say yes. Yes. But still give me the bread. God help me here. Yes, but give me the bread. Oh no, you ain't covenant, you dog. Bark, bark, you dog. But every dog has its day. And today, because I know how to worship and accept the truth. Okay, I'm going to say it one more time. Wine represents the blood. Bread represents his body broken for you. But in today, Martin Day, 2015. God help us here. And even in the Bible days, I'll find it for you somewhere in Genesis, that the bread or the dough was also considered money. God help me here. God help me here. Because they had first fruit offerings. First fruit offerings was the first thing that came through as a breakthrough. So in other words, if they received their first check from their new job, the first check was their first fruit. Do you understand? And that first fruit, the Bible says, they could bring it to the temple, but there was also, you could bring it and give it to the priest of the house. Come on, come on. Don't get quiet when we talk about offerings. Because there's a blessing in giving. Now, I'm telling you what I know, because I had somebody in the Harvest Kingdom Church. I won't mention him because he gets on my nerves, but I won't say his name, but he didn't have a job for months. I'm talking about months, living wherever he can find a place to lay his head, which included my residence, my church office. I just didn't want to see him on the street. He finally got a job. And when he got this job working at the airport, he brings the entire first check and puts it in my hand and said, "This is my first fruit." Now, what is said in the Bible is that when you give first fruit offerings, that God promises them, he has to like open up some doors that just blows your mind. It's like I'm gonna do a study on it for you. I'm gonna do a Bible study for it on that first fruit offering. And so next thing you know, after he gave it, about 2 weeks later, a job that was paying 10 times more, much better benefits, opened up. And when he got that check, He came and brought that. And when he brought that check, a lawsuit check came. God help me. So I need about 10 people. I'm going to my seat. I'm going to my chair now. I got to go. I need 10 people that's praisers, that believe God. Go find at least 3 people that you can connect with. You understand? If they look like folk that ain't going nowhere, look at them and say, true. Okay. Okay. Because you got no reality. You understand? Got no truth. True. Hallelujah. If they're looking at you like you phony, like you ain't about nothing, and they don't want to praise God, leave them alone. True. No shade, but true. Find somebody you can praise God with and tell that name when you get them. Tell them, I'm about to get the bread. No, no. I ain't talking about the body of Jesus Christ now. I'm talking about the money that comes when you serve Jesus Christ. I need you to find somebody and say, neighbor, I'm about to get my bread. Get my bread. The loss. If I have about 20 people in here that experience great loss, get ready. You're about to get your bread. Your hands, we gotta go. Lift your hands, we gotta go. There is life. There is life. There is life. There is life. Put your hand on your neighbor's right shoulder and say, I command you to live. Lay your hand on your neighbor's shoulder and say, neighbor, I command you to live. And I command you to praise. Let everything that have breath praise Him. Command your feet to start moving. Oh, glory to God. Glory to God. It's when it's over. It's hallelujah. Hallelujah. God. Lift your hands, everybody. Hallelujah. It's when, hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's a praise in here. I'm trying to bring it in. There's a praise in here. I'm trying to bring it in. Hallelujah. I dare you from the city of your soul, shout one more time. I'm getting my bread. I need your glory. I want your glory. All of you and less of me is what I need. Show me your glory. Because I need that glory. All of you and less of me is what I need. Could you slip your hands up, everybody? Could you say it again? I need your glory. I want your glory. Less of me and more of you is what I need your glory. I need your glory. Can you slip your hands up and worship all over this building?
I want your glory.
Yes.
All my less of me and more of you is what I need.
Come on, show me your glory. Show
me your glory.
Show me your power.
Show me your power.
Less of me.
Less of me and more of you is what I need.
Can the church say that? Show me your glory.
Show me your glory.
Show me, Lord.
Show me your power.
Show me your power.
Less of me and more of you is what I need.
It's when the individual can now face truth. Stop running from it. Learn to handle truth. When you learn to handle truth, then maybe you might say, you know what? What am I doing? What am I doing? I'm being lazy. I'm being weak. most dangerous things, though, is try to believe in a false truth. That's dangerous. And I'll give you an example as we worship. Some years ago, I first started pastoring. Immediately, it seemed like a large group of people came to my church. And my name got out. Popular, just popular. Everybody stand. We here. And now I've got this popularity all around New York City. Now I done hit Jersey, Connecticut. It's going down 95. I'm preaching for a lot of people. Folk are coming to the church. And one day, I went to a conference at Creflo Dollars Church. Went to World Changers. And I stayed there for 3 days. And I went all around his church on tours and stuff. And tours that people couldn't go on because I knew people that worked for his ministry. And one of the first things I saw when I came into the parking lot, I saw 6 tractor trailers that said World Changers on it, Creflo Dollar Ministries. I said, what's those for? I said, well, he goes on his crusade, his car goes up inside of one of them. We have computers that run everything that's going on inside is being ran out from the truck. I said, whoa, there's 6 of them. We put all our equipment in these things. I went around the church. I went to service at night. 8,000 people, 8,500 people, jam-packed in the place. I said, Lord, gee. I went to the church gymnasium. And immediately, that false truth that I had on me, to think I was something, fell off of me. And said, maybe right now I'm a lot of hype and I need to get to working because I'm nowhere where I should be. I went back to New York like, it's time to work. And not just be popular. I'm not saying I could be Creflo Dollar because it is true that only churches with 2,000 or more people only make up 11% of churches. So it's not it ain't about being the next Creflo because Creflo is who God made him. But I know that I could be more effective if I get off popularity and look at assignment. Could I tell you something too? Popularity is not always what you want. When you get popular, people will run with stuff, spread stuff. They go all over the world because you're popular. Well, I see somebody else that's done 100 times worse than you, and it goes undetected. But because you popular, all your business and the lies. Another thing that goes with popularity is sometimes people's way to your stage is to pick fights with you. There's times people picked fights with me. So I would give them the attention, and now they could become somebody because now they're on the stage that they couldn't get.
Right.
Yeah. You have to understand something. You have to know truth. The woman said, I'm a dog, but I still want the bread. Come to that place of truth. You'll see blessings. And you will see change. You see blessings and you see change. I know we just finished coming out of a shout, but let me say this. Sometimes when we're emotionally high, pastors usually find that the best time to lift an offering. But I always bring us back down. Because if I preach to your pocketbook, I'll get nothing. But if
if I preach to your heart, you'll always want to be a blessing. Let me tell you something, church. We've got to come to the place that we stop playing around, not with the church, but with yourself. Amen. And start to own some stuff. And start to read your own self. And say, yeah, you know what? Underneath my church dress, everything that's being said about me is not a lie. Some of it is truth. And I get mad when people tell me truth, instead of being challenged to do better. You should not become mad or upset more than something should kick up in you and say, I've got to be better than this. When do we get better? When you discover that it's not a lie, it's the truth. Somebody called you ignorant. It's the truth. Yeah, it's the truth. Davenport, you a hothead. That was the truth back then. My best friend called me that. I said, don't you go to that preacher's church no more. Darryl Hill, cut him off. Don't go to his church. Darryl said, I supposed to have him at my church next Sunday. Well, I supposed to cancel him because you mad? I said, no, he offended both of us because we boys. He said, well, that's when he comes, I'll be the one that, you know, try to mend this thing. Let me be the one to fix it then. Let me mend it and fix it. But I'm not going to cut him off. I got out that man's truck. I slammed the door and swore I'd never talk to him again. He said, he rolled out the window. He said, you're a hothead. God go deal with you. I got more upset. You know why I got upset? Because it was the truth. It was the truth. And in about a week or so, I didn't just call Darryl Hill. Because he did have him to his church, too. I waited till like a couple days, say a week and some days. I called the preacher up himself. I said, you know, I apologize. I said, I caused a great disturbance. No, it was his fault, though. It was. He approached me in a way that was in a threatening manner. But I said, I'll stand before your church on a Sunday morning. I will leave my pulpit and come to your church on a Sunday morning and apologize to your entire church if you would allow me. You know why? Because I need to know the truth. And the truth is, me having a spirit on me of anger and having a hot head, my reaction was the problem, not the action that was against me. Because the reaction determines the conclusion of the situation. He said, well, you don't have to do that, Davenport. I'm going to bring my whole church to your church and I'm going to apologize. I said, no, now we're going back and forth by apologies. But I thank God for a truth that brought me deliverance. Pastor Monique, at the time, me and her were dating. And I expected for her to understand and be on my side. God, I take you out to eat too much for you to be against me. I spent too much for you not to understand and be on my side. Cheesecake factories and all these other factories. Her words to me was this. Not only does God know you're a hothead, but the devil does too. And he's going to use your temper to destroy you. About to cut her off for good. Cut her off for good. This cannot be my girlfriend telling me that. truth of the matter is not only am I hothead, but the truth of the matter is I'm the only son of three children. And not only was I a hothead, but I was spoiled. You understand what I'm saying? Spoiled. And spoiled people always needed to go your way. And you don't know how to handle when it doesn't go your way. And if somebody calls you spoiled, then you really, I've gone through things you haven't gone through. You have received more good than bad. You have had more good days than bad days. You're spoiled. My first marriage, hey man, I'm sure I took my ex-wife through because I was spoiled. Yeah. I don't understand her not spoiling me. Spoiled. I need you to be like my mom. Affirm me. Always speak high of me. Speak great to me. And the first time a woman ever said something that was not affirmation, it hurt me. When it should not, she was just being honest. It's true. I hope I'm helping you out. Because if I don't say this, then I'm not a pastor. I'm just an evangelist that comes to make you shout. And that I won't be to you. Know the truth. And the truth shall set you free. Today, I'm a hothead under control. Now I'm a hothead that God got my mouth under arrest. That knows I can't go everywhere saying everything. You understand? I still have the potential to explode. But God and my destiny that he showed me. You understand? And I'm more mature to think about where I'm going and see the tricks of the enemy that hampers my growth. If you don't want to grow, stay how you are. And ignore the truth. Some of you in here, you're angry. And that's the truth of the matter is. Because you've been hurt. And you're broken. And you're angry. And does anybody call you that? I ain't broken. I ain't broken. I'm fine. It's just you. No, you're broken. You're broken because you don't know how to handle yourself when things get. Listen, some of us, and I promise you I'm going to do a series on unhealthy emotions. Because some of us are unhealthy emotionally. And that doesn't happen because you had been in relationships. And relationships and relationships. And more relationships and more relations. And love and relations is risky business. It can help you, and it can almost half kill you. It could be something that brings you joy, or it could be something that takes you to the nut house. Sitting somewhere with a helmet on your head. But there is a God that comes not just to make you feel good, but to expose to you who you are and then what he can be and what he calls you to be and what he wants you to be and where he will take you. Which is much farther than you can take yourself. standing. I'm sorry. We're all standing. We're all standing. Is there anyone here today that you're not saved? When I say not saved, I'm not talking about you came to the altar last Sunday and then you cursed on Monday, so now you're coming back down here again. That means you got some unhealthy emotions. Not that you're not saved. You know, that means you may be a little angry, but that doesn't mean you're not saved. Amen. Once you give your life to God, guess what? He takes it seriously. And he comes inside of you because you asked him to do that. Now you have to mature. Amen. When I say you're no longer saved or you backslid, that means you know the will of God and you turned your back and decided to walk the opposite way. No longer willing to serve God. Amen? Okay? I'm not talking about shortcomings, because those things have to be taught out, schooled out, counseled out, cast out. Amen?
Amen.
So, and I should put the cast out on the first one. Amen. Some of y'all just need a touch of the Lord, and we need to say, get loose here. Remember old school, loose here. In the name of the Lord Jesus, loose your stronghold. The blood of Jesus be against you, Satan. You go back to the pit of hell where you came from. The blood. And can I tell you something? Get somebody a high five and say, the blood works. I said, the blood still works. I still go home and walk around in my house and say, the blood of Jesus. I still lay hands on doorknobs and say, the blood of Jesus. Y'all like having church here, but I bet you I'll have church in my home. Make the anointing so great in my house that when the devil come in here, he starts slipping on oil. He can't even get his traction. So much oil on the floor. Y'all used to this organ and stuff, but I promise you, I know how to shout a cappella right in my kitchen. God, do it. Hey. All in the bedroom, you better believe it. Hallelujah. I don't know about y'all, but have you ever done like what I did yesterday? I was at a light and all of a sudden my hands went up. Tears poured down my eyes. I had to pull a car over, start saying, thank you, Jesus. I had to start speaking in the Holy Ghost. I don't know what God was doing, but he was doing something. I started interceding. I started going before the Lord. I don't know what the devil had on the next exit for me, but the blood, God help me. I feel a deliverance here, and I'm going to say this. I don't know what's on your next exit, but I dare somebody say the blood of Jesus on this highway. God help me. Hallelujah. We got to get out of here. Is there anyone here under the sound of my voice that you're not saved or you backslid? Come to Jesus. Come get this bread. Come to Jesus. Get out your seat. Get out your seat. Find your way to Jesus. I'm glad this is on DVD because I promise you, I don't have one note anywhere. I was sick as a dog and God started speaking to me at 7 o'clock this morning. Hallelujah. I don't have not one thing written down. If you're here, I'm glad that everybody's going to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we will shout for the victory. Sing and shout for the victory. God bless you. Heaven smile upon you. Amen. I want everybody in this building. Next week is our Back to Church Sunday. And I would like everybody that can, that this week, that you put something to the side for next week, Back to Church Sunday. Put something to the side. Let's come with the intention that also, you know, church has been, you know, this way and that way during the summer. Let's be a blessing financially. Amen? Amen? Put something to the side. Put something to the side. Amen? I know you. Some of you are going to buy your children some new phones or something. Give that phone money to the Lord. Get them phone money to the Lord. Get them just a pair of Keds or something for now. Amen. Keds are in style. Praise the Lord. Amen. Buy them a pair of little Nike flip-flops. Y'all can say what y'all want about these kids wearing these flip-flops. They cost $35. Yes, flop around all you want. Flop.com. Amen. Go to Flop. Amen. Amen. But let's be a blessing unto the Lord. This is our tithes and our offering. And this church is a 100% tithing church because we believe in giving 10% back to God of anything he has blessed us with, anything and everything. If you're not a tither, amen, come up in your faith and believe God because it is necessary. It is his book, Old Testament and New Testament. You will find it. If you don't have an understanding of tithing, I'm not going to beat you over the head. But won't you set up a meeting with me and at least get the word so that you're going to understand. Maybe you don't have an understanding. Sometimes the church beat people over the head and they don't have an understanding is the problem. So won't we set up a meeting so I can give you what the scripture says and then let God be God. Amen? Amen. That's what I believe. But I know I believe in tithing. Last week I was going through some stuff financially last week. And I was in New York. I was scheduled to preach at the New York church on Sunday morning. And Bishop Showell called me and said, my brother passed away. I need you to come to Baltimore. I said, well, how many services do you want before? He said, 8 and 11. I pay a tuition every month for my son, Juwan. That's quite hefty. So I need all the money I can get these days. I preached 2 services and received a check for $3,000. And at his church, you can't preach more than 50 minutes. So what's that? $1,500 an hour? That's all right, isn't it? It's all right. God will make it up in other ways when you're faithful. I wasn't expecting that because the truth of the matter is my spiritual father, Bishop Showell, could come and say, I ain't giving you nothing. And I'm a priest just as hard. I would because I love him. You know? My kids love Bishop Showell's church. And every time he called, 8, 11, or 8 and 11? That's my question. Amen. Because I'm on my way. Amen. That's what God would do for you. I hurt my foot one time, had surgery, had to cancel all my engagements. About 15 engagements went down the drain. As soon as I got a boot on my foot, one church asked me to come. I said, I'm on a boot. I can't walk. They said, well, sit down and preach. I said, I just finished getting 30-something staples removed out of my leg. And doctor said it would take a year. Do you know, I went in a boot, and God told me, stand up in the boot. And what took a year took 3 months. He healed me right while I was preaching. I was only supposed to be preaching on Wednesday and Friday. But when I finished preaching on Wednesday, they said, no, you preach tomorrow night too. We're canceling the preacher for tomorrow. We're going to put you tomorrow night. Then after I finished preaching Friday, he said, stay until Sunday and do 2 services with me on Sunday. And when I got my check, after all those engagements that canceled for me, the check was $8,500. Me and that boot went to moving. Holy Ghost boot now. Some folk could praise him as long as they're not afflicted, but can you praise him when you're afflicted and still do God's will? God bless you. Listen, I'm just sharing that with you, not to brag, because $8,000 is nothing compared to what God will do. That's a little chump change that I just grateful for the change. And I only call it change because God can do exceedingly and abundantly. And what he could do is absolutely awesome and super. And I need a church that understands that God is going to do some supernatural things when it comes to your life and your finances if you follow his principles and his statutes. If you follow him, he's going to do some things for you that's going to blow your mind. And I'm telling you, I speak it now. I declare it in this atmosphere that the years of financial bondage, the years of poverty, the years of great struggle will come to an end. Hallelujah. Even by October, that God, they will start seeing financial increase hit their lives, that ideas they have now come alive again. And now, God, you connect their ideas to people that can help finance it. In the name of the Lord Jesus, we loose supernatural financial miracles in this house. In the name of the Lord Jesus, increase on jobs, promotions. God, help us own businesses. In the name of Jesus, entrepreneurs, in the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you for it. We thank you for the plan. We thank you for the ideas. We thank you for helping us in Jesus' name. We say amen. Come on, shout hallelujah. All tithers, come on. All tithers are coming. All tithers are coming. Hallelujah. What scripture did I read from? Deuteronomy 34, 5 through 8. Would y'all join me? Those that's coming online with your tithes, would you join me with a seed of $34 to put it on the word of God? $34. A seed of $34.